Today, Salut will talk about, as Dinda said, today it's about maternal issue related to COVID-19. And it's very, to a degree, a sad topic because we are talking about pregnant mothers with COVID and how they related to their babies. Okay, Salut, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you, Turo. Selamat pagi. Selamat siang di sini, dan juga terima kasih. Shall I speak in English or Indonesia? So
it's in English.
It's so, in English. Okay. So this is part of the forum kebijakan pembangunan FKP. So I have to talk in English. So nice to see almost everyone. Some of them I can see already very familiar faces, and I feel like I put in my Facebook said pulang kampung because yes, demography, Lembaga Demografi is my first institute where I have not I have to but kind of like push to learn about demography by Professor Arisananda. Anyway, that's long shot. So today I would like to share my study, recent study one. Anyone see it? Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. Okay. So there are two things that I would like to propose in this presentation. It's basically about the methodology, systematic review, and then the content itself about maternal coronavirus infection in neonates born to mother with COVID-19. So yes, as the director of the LDOE, Pak Turo mentioned, not only as a demographer at Macquarie University, but I also has been appointed as a young researcher since last year, yeah, 2 years back with it, Lembaga Demografi. So I have to disclaim for this paper in particular. This is not only myself, but also from my student from Iran. She is Mariam Pinze, and then her supervisor, Mo Ghazam, who based in Iran. They're supposed to come here in July, this last month, but then because of coronavirus, we postponed it a bit until November. So in the meantime, so that's why we can working on some paper together. So as I said, today I'm going to present two things about the systematic review itself, and then the second one is about the study on mother with COVID-19. So, the background of this paper is basically when we start to do this, it was kind of like in the, almost like in the March and April period when coronavirus is kind of like really, really kind of like the peak season everywhere. So then we kind of like thinking about, because of my student research talking going to be about the reproductive health, pregnant women. So then with kind of idea, why don't we look at that? What is the implication of this pandemic COVID-19 to mothers and also the neonatal board? So this is basically just brief information about what happens, what is the corona COVID-19. So basically the idea is saying that COVID-19, yes, looks like familiar names, severe acute respiratory syndrome coronavirus, but this is having the second type of that coronavirus. So that's why they put S2 in the back one. So they claim it is S new virus. Why it is 19? Because it was found in the first place in Wuhan back in December 2019. Otherwise, they put S2020 novel coronavirus. So when you look at the transmission, it is categorized as the zoonotic. It means not only from animal, but also can also with the people. So yes, in the first place, they kind of like suspected it was coming from the animal. But then when it is become infected to many people, then everyone kind of like surprised. Yeah, this is kind of like happening to between people as well. So human-to-human transmission can be by coughing or sneezing, or from the droplet people, also as close personal contact with them for touching. The last one, back in May or June, they found is also by facial contamination. So anything that can like eating by that one and then going back to like to the toilets, that's also kind of like the faces could also kind of like having that one. So it's still kind of like investigated again and again. So in other words, the COVID-19 is still kind of like many unknown. And then what we know today may change in the future. We don't yet. So that's why when someone, if you remember, there is a new interview about the finding the antidote of the coronavirus. They said it's going to kind of like influence DNA, which is not DNA. This is RNA rather than DNA. So that's why it may change every time. So in other words, it's kind of like anyone can be exposed to the risk, either males, females, either you are young or old. And most of at risk is person who have been in contact with infected person because of the respiratory droplet in particular. And then in particular for pregnant women, they could be also high risk because if they go to the hospital or the health facility, so in what way that someone may become like asymptomatic, which is kind of like not showing the symptom, but then they have that one, so that could become like risk for them as well. So then our question in order to do this study is questioning about, are there any risks of vertical or perinatal transmission to newborn baby from a mother who has been positive for COVID-19? So that's kind of like the big question that we want to ask. Because if you kind of like from conversation and then you meet each other on the transportation, you can like seeing each other. But what about from mother to the from mother to the baby when it is kind of like still in the pregnant? Yeah. So when we are doing it, it's still kind of like less known about this one. So up to April and May 2020. So our first discussion is about review. So we are doing it in the idea because of our distance. So Iran in Australia, as well as I think it's a lot of people doing it now too. I think the best to do it is by using the review. But the question is that which review do you want to do? Because if you look at the literature, there are several review, which is in particular at least 14, either narrative review, rapid review, scoping review, or systematic review. The question is that what is different between one to the others? Yeah? So the narrative is basically, if someone put this one is based on how much evidence, how high the evidence that you have. If it is only like few or only kind of like something new things, maybe you start with narrative review and then you go to the either quick or to rapid review. And then if it is kind of like more evidence or kind of like having a lot of literature, then yeah, you can do for the systematic review. So the difference between those things is systematic review in particular has kind of like a research question, what the question that you want to ask. In on the other hand, scoping and rapid is basically just kind of like preliminary or providing information rather than asking some question to be proved. Yeah, so that's basically the main difference between one to the others. You can Google based looking at what is not narrative review, what is the rapid review, or what is scoping review. So if you don't have a lot of evidence yet, I think you start with kind of like narrative and then go to the scope and it's a rapid review. In particular, one of the article in the BMC Medical Research asking that when do you want to do systematic and when do you want to do scoping review? The recommendation is that in order to do scoping review, if the purpose is only to identify knowledge gap, scope of body literature, clarify concept or to investigate research conduct. And then that can be used as kind of like leading you for the systematic review. Yeah. So that in other words, kind of like systematic review can be start by looking at the scope first. And then when you find more and more evidence, yeah, you can do the systematic review. That's the idea. What, how many minutes I have to. Okay, just remind me someone here. Yeah. Okay, so systematic review is basically a lot of steps, but in general, we can classify into 7 main steps. The first one, as I said, you have to get the question. Okay, what the question that particularly you want to ask? Don't too kind of like too broad. You have to be very specific in order to answer that. Say like, what the characteristic? Then you have to kind of like a lot of things. You have to be more specific. Say like, what the color or what is the object, like the mother and then the COVID-19 and then the newborn. That's kind of like more specific question. Systematic searching and retrieving literature. So there is kind of like a specific method to do that one. And then you have kind of like establishing relevant criteria to screen it, whether by date, how long date back you want to do it. In our case, it's basically just starting when the COVID-19 was found until the time that we are doing it. The setting, it could be general, like everywhere, global, or particular, like for example, Indonesia. And then the design, what you want to find. Is it more random, qualitative, quantitative only, and so on? Like, is it kind of like only English, or it can be many language, and so on, okay? So after that, you have to do kind of like assessing study for relevance, whether it's relevance or not with your question. And then you do have appraisal, assess the methodology. So that's kind of like something make the systematic difference between compared with others. There is kind of like appraisal of the methodological quality. After that, then you do some extraction of data, and then you do kind of like a discussion, and then synthesis or also interpretation, and then present it. So, but the important one is systematic review require fairly a broad sample of literature. It's not only like few, but a need bigger one in the first place. And then the novelty of this one is something new say, rather than discovering creating something new, because the evidence already there. You just need something new to say how it's happening. And then the timeline of the topic is big deal in review article. Like COVID-19 today is very like critical. You have to do it now. Otherwise, if you do it later on, it's later on, maybe already too late. Someone already do it. Okay. So this is one of the method of the step in terms of systematic review that been proposed by Prisma. There are other steps that has been proposed by their organization, but this one is kind of like the most common people use. So the first one is identification. So you basically using some database, identify what you want to find, and then you need to do screening. Usually by screening is looking at the title and abstract only. Some people sometimes just using kind of like the keyword, yeah? So the important is how do we put the good keyword, because sometimes like the keyword may be like with capital C or with the only small C may also make something different. So that's kind of like methodology that we can do maybe later on another time. We can talk about this. Once you have the screening and then eligibility. The eligibility is basically you do kind of like appraisal. How relevant this one, whether the quality of this good or not, and then whether this is kind of like answering your question as well. So that kind of like coming to the included one, then you have to kind of like reading. Anyway, for eligibility, you need to kind of like open the full text article, because otherwise you don't have the whole picture certainly. So once you have that, and then you put into the inclusion, and then you do some synthesis and analysis on that. Okay, so this is one of the example or two examples that how to use kind of like the synthesis appraisal one, okay? They call it as a SQAT from NIH, National Institute of Health. Usually they use kind of like for health research, like because they have some like method of case report studies, case control studies, but also if you are doing a mixed method appraisal, like quantitative or qualitative, or another one like a GBI, I didn't put this one, you can just use specific one, either quantitative only or qualitative only, or there are randomized control and so on. So there are several things that you may want to do it. So later on, I'm going to show you how to do it. So I think that's like giving you an idea what is the systematic review. This is just give you an idea, mixed method appraisal tools. Like if you have, for example, there are questions about qualitative, asking about yes or no or can tell. If answer everything is yes, it's most like the quality is very good, then yeah, you include that one. Or the quantitative or the qualitative or combined between that one, there is some question that need to be kind of answered. You may want to include that into your systematic review if the answer is most everything yes to that one. Yeah. So I think that's the discussion for systematic review. I have colleague here from Queensland University of Technology, Jericho Pardosi. He's more kind of like advanced in terms of systematic review. If everyone, maybe later on, we can also invite him to come like giving seminar on the systematic review. But anyway, that's the systematic review. The second one, my discussion is about the study itself. So as I said, the study background basically want to know about what is known about the risk of vertical and perinatal transmission to a newborn baby from a mother who has positive COVID-19. So vertical and perinatal is basically like, if we can like between people who's having conversation, then we can see whether by wearing masks, yeah, whether they can like having droplet or not, or we can like keep distant. But what about mother or the pregnant mother with the baby, baby who's still in the pregnancy, or when they were giving birth? So the question is that, can it be transferred by vertical? So that's kind of like vertical, either by the, apa itu namanya, pusar-pusar ari-arinya, or placenta, or kind of like when you're giving delivery, skin-to-skin method when they were born, does it going to be kind of affected the newborn baby? So if yes, and then how big is the risk to do that one? So that's we want to know about what's going on. The search strategy that we have is we are using the database that's very relevant from the publication of medicine, PubMed, and then Scopus, also Embase, ProQuest, Science Direct. And sometimes at the end, when we to do the screening one, we also sometimes doing the manual choose and selection, yeah, because sometimes it's not been able to be covered in this one. You may use kind of like for Indonesia, like Sinta, and then also anything with you can like title and abstract in there, then you can search with the database. For the language, we aim for English in particular, but also because of it is global, so we would like to use also try to be local language. Like my student from Iran, she included with the what is the Iranian language, man, something like Hebrew and so on. That's kind of like if she can translate, or Indonesian in particular, if I can translate that one. But at the end, we cover everything, but then we look at that, the quality. So the type of publications, we aim in particular because of we want to make this is kind of like the evidence. So we aim for the studies with having the original data. Yeah, either case report, case series, either descriptive or observational studies, or in the controlled trials where the data of the patient, of the mother, were included in that one. Because we really want to find out step by step what happened to the pregnant mother when they give delivery, and then what happened with the newborn baby. So the keyword, we're using several combination, either COVID-19 with a C, a small c, a small letter, COVID-19 with the capital letters, with the SARS or with the COV2, or novel coronavirus, with pregnancy, prenatal, neonatal features, a lot of combination we use in order to kind of like gaining all kind of like the database. And this is kind of like the step we have. So in the first place, we have 1,463 by using that database, but also we have from other sources like Google Scholars, I remember that's around 9 additional on that one. But then we removed that one by screening duplications. So from 1,472, there are 433 duplications. So we got about 939 screening. And then we screen again based on relevancies. We got until 11. But then when we pull the 11 studies about the text, the full text, there are two in particular were not quite relevant with our study. So we end up having only 9 studies that having very valid and robust studies. Data were there, step by step, the methodologies there, and also kind of like the clinical report also there. So that's basically what we use. Okay, so I said already before, so we start with 1,472, and then we exclude because of duplication as well as because of relevancies. And then once we screening with the quality, we end up with having 11, but then final, we choose only 9 studies included because of the relevance as well as the high quality studies one. And it is not surprising for me, most of the study that we select finally is we're basically from China, where the original region from Wuhan Center actually, because they are the one who's kind of like Wuhan University is really kind of like actively producing, doing some kind of like monitoring to the pregnant women in the hospital. Then they reported what the case was. So they are become like getting a lot of attention during that time period. I bet by this time, I also just recently looking at other article, there are more cases already reported in US, in Italy, as well in Spanish, which was not available during when we are looking for that one. Okay, so as I said before, in order to kind of like to include why it's only like 9 rather than 1,400 in the beginning, that because of the application were there and then the relevancy is not there, but also the quality. That's kind of like making the difference. The quality is not there yet. So we have to make sure most of the quality, for example, in our study, we are using SQAT, Study Quality Assessment Tools. So there are kind of like, for the case report studies, there are 9 item that we need to kind of like comply. So if the answer for those items, say for example, the quality, the relevancies, the data, and then the analysis. So if say yes, then yeah, we put everything. And then the same thing with the case control, the quality of the study, the data is there, and then a lot of things that reporting very relevant and high quality, then we include it. Yeah, few some of like, for example, in study number 7, Wong, there is kind of like item number 3 is not available. But in general, like more than 50%, the quality of this one is good. So then, yeah, we include that one. Okay, so. Enough? Yeah, I think 3 more minutes. I know that the time, I'm really conscious about time. So the result, okay. So most of the study that we include the age of mother between 22 to 40 years old. And then when they start in the studies, they already in third trimester, is basically almost toward to the delivery period one. For anyone who has kind of like diagnosis for having COVID-19, the symptom is kind of like very similar with those who are not pregnant. Say like a fever and cough symptom, as well as there is kind of like very detailed history, how do they get infected, whether this is from the family or from outside or anything and the other one. Okay. But also in that study, we found that very detailed report about the characteristic and of kind of the obstetric, like whether this mother has comorbidities or not, and where how many people can like how many mothers with and without comorbidities, because we want to know about the outcome after that one. Yeah, mode of delivery. To believe it or not, most I think it's like a 79 out of 86, almost like 90% delivery with cesarean, because they were kind of like the fear at that moment is because of when they're breathing, they can like have short breath, right? So that's why they requested mostly from the mother asking cesarean instead of kind of like normal delivery because of the difficulty in breathing. That's because of they got the symptom of the COVID-19 one. And then about the vertical transmission potential COVID-19, most of the, I think seven of them saying that no at all, there is no indication. And then other three saying there is kind of like indication, but it's not in, not conclusive, kind of like still trivial. So it can be debatable whether that's result from that one or not, from the COVID-19 or not. But then, so the most of the answer is there is no evidence that happening vertical transmission from the mother who has COVID-19 to the children who are COVID, to the newborn baby. The neonatal outcomes are mostly normal weight, surprisingly, but then there were few underweight because of they were born prematurely before the period, the time of they have to kind of like to be born. So that's kind of like a good news one. Last one, the discussion. The implication of COVID-19 to pregnant women is basically, yes, if you can imagine that being women at the last trimester and then basically ready to give birth, and then you are infected by coronavirus. So having a difficulty in breathing as well as kind of like having coughing all the time is making like you nervous at the same time, right? But also going to visit the clinic where you never knows what's happening in that clinic, either anyone having COVID-19 or not, is also make them kind of like even care. So due to situation, the recommendation most of from the paper saying that more attention should be given to the unique needs of pregnant women. Yeah, proper and careful treatment also should be applied. Like for example, prompt admission of mother if they are in negative pressure isolation is very crucial because they don't want to kind of like coming is with negative but then going out from the hospital become positive because of that admission. The other thing is all medical staff responsible for taking care of COVID-19 patients should also kind of like utilize personal protective equipment because it could be from mothers to the medical staff, but also medical staff who are asymptomatic could to the mother as well. So in critical case, pregnancy can put the mother and fetus in danger. So early termination then is kind of like necessary, even in premature pregnancy need to be done. Last but not least, standard health protocol has to be applied. That's kind of like almost everyone saying standard health protocol has to be applied, such as avoiding unnecessary travel, use public transport, or be in the crowd situation for a pregnant mother. I think that's my the end of presentation. Thank you very much.
Terima kasih banyak Pak Salut atas materi yang disampaikan dan sangat relevan serta menarik sekali. Bapak Ibu sekalian, apabila ada pertanyaan silahkan memanfaatkan fitur raise your hand. Dan kemudian nanti kami akan pilih pertanyaan dari Bapak Ibu sekalian. Ya.
Atau bisa juga pakai chatting, nggak bisa, nggak boleh ya? Kalau di...
Saya sebagai host tidak bisa menggunakan feature raise hand, but I have a couple of questions.
If yes,
I...
please, Mbak Lydia.
Yeah, so it seems that your review is very extensive, Pak, and it's quite... heartening, yeah, to see that it's actually not as risky as we thought, that there's no transmission being found from infected mother to baby. But were there really no cases of infection? And if there is maybe one or two or other, because I've seen in news in Indonesia that there were newborn babies being infected. But people were not sure whether because it was transmission or because the babies were infected at the hospital. Yeah, so is this something that you found? So another thing is that does that mean that pregnant women are not as vulnerable as we thought? Because nowadays we see that in at malls, at the church, places of worship, they don't allow pregnant women to come to join the service and attend the mall. Is this warranted, you think, or are they not really that vulnerable in reality? Thank you.
Okay. Shall I answer directly? Yeah, okay. Thank you, Lydia. Yes, as I said, the study that we've done is until March, April 2020, yeah, when it was kind of like still in the early stage of COVID-19. I can say that so far, even in United States, the recent one, I think the journal was published back in June or July. They also found that in terms of vertical, is still no evidence directly. Yeah, but all the studies recommend that the treatment that can affect more to the pregnant women as well as the newborn baby. That's why they even do it like this. So during the pregnancy, they test the fetus. And then after 1 day, they test, and then 14 days after. So compare between those stage one. And then 75%, there is no indication of the baby having a coronavirus positive one. But there are, I think, one or two case study. The mother said that the baby looked like having symptom like coughing, but then the mother didn't want to test that baby. So that's why they said inconclusive whether that kind of like having because of the mother having coronavirus or because of after 14 days they were born and then kind of like contaminated with the surrounding. So that's why I said it's trivial, but in general said there is no. And then the question is that why women should not be kind of like in the very crowded area one? Because most of the study we see here is basically, if you remember, there are three or four type of the disease one. Someone who is completely didn't show the symptom, and then someone has kind of like only mild or kind of like early stage one, and then someone who's kind of like very severe one. And those mother that in this study having not kind of like the heavy condition is mostly either kind of like early stage or like kind of like mild coughing or fever, as I said. So that's why that could kind of like the reason why the transmission didn't happen between the mother and the newborn baby. So I haven't find yet any studies who is kind of like mother in very critical situation and then giving birth either by cesarean or normal and then tested the mother. I hope I would like to find something. Thanks, Bu Lydia.
Okay. It's good to hear. Terima kasih, Pak.
Baik, terima kasih, Bu Lydia. Saya kembali ke Mbak. Apabila Bapak Ibu ada pertanyaan, dipersilahkan. Kalau saya ingin bertanya sedikit, Pak Salut, sambil menunggu Bapak Ibu yang lain nge-post pertanyaannya. Tadi ada comorbidities ya, karakteristik ibu bapak. Apakah bisa diceritakan Pak variasi comorbidities dan kemudian impact-nya juga gitu orang yang dengan comorbidities dengan level severity seperti apa, kemudian outcome bayinya seperti apa gitu. Terima kasih Pak.
Oke. Terima kasih. About comorbidities, only one study have comorbidities, saying about that one. But mostly the comorbidity is not really very serious one, like the pneumonia and then asthma, as well as something to do with the respiratory system one. So that's why kind of like the medical doctor worry about whether that can look giving more impact to the result of when they give birth. So, but then it wasn't happening because the choice of giving cesarean. So kind of like maybe like to avoid, in order kind of like to heavy breathing during the delivery. So that could also kind of like making different ones. But that's only I can tell. If I have my student here, she can tell more because she's kind of like from the medical background.
Pak, atas penjelasannya, Bapak Ibu yang lain, apa ada pertanyaan?
Okay. I think sometimes ago also Indonesia has done studies, but it's not really comprehensive yet about the impact of COVID-19 to the mothers in pregnancy. Like I remember BKKBN Yaturo sometimes ago they talking about the impact of COVID-19 to the service or something like the delivery service or the reproductive health service in Indonesia. But they only seen until how to give service to the mothers during the pregnant, but not yet until the impact one. We have several people here understand about health. I see Ibu Rahmalina from Litbangkes.
Ibu bisa mengajukan pertanyaan dalam bahasa Indonesia, kami persilahkan.
Ya, terima juga.
Oke, terima kasih Bu Dinda. Pak Salut, apa kabar? It's very interesting presentation actually. Ya, saya dari Badan Litbangkes, Pak Salut, kolik saya yang paling dekat dengan saya dan kita sering sekali bekerja sama. Untuk Lembaga Demografi, congratulations buat ulang tahunnya.
Terima kasih, Bu.
Ya, sukses terus. Ada satu pertanyaan Pak Salut yang saya belum lihat di paparan Pak Salut. Mungkin maaf saya pakai bahasa Indonesia aja ya, bahasa Inggrisnya.
Silakan, silakan.
Pak, biar Pak Salutnya juga ingat bisa bahasa Indonesianya makin
kangen.
Kangen. Ngelepas kangen. Ya, jadi paparannya bagus sekali, tapi saya belum lihat kalau di Indonesia itu kan peran keluarga sangat berarti ya. Yeah, kita yeah. Di sini kekeluargaannya kuat sekali, apalagi sekarang di masa pandemi seperti ini. Apakah di systematic review Pak Salut keluar family roles in related with pregnant women? Apakah dia ikut mengantar ke klinik kunjungan memeriksa ANC-nya? Terus bagaimana dengan, karena itu juga termasuk yang beresiko ya nanti kalau keluarga yang bawa itu. Apakah Pak Salut melihat peran keluarga dalam pregnant women di masa pandemi ini? Itu aja. Terima kasih.
Ya, terima kasih. Langsung ya, Mbak Dinda.
Silakan, Pak.
Terima kasih untuk pertanyaannya, Mbak Ina. Mbak Ina salah satu kolik saya yang sering kita riset ya bareng di NTT Kupang sama ini. Untuk yang bahasan dari studi saya ini ya, dengan student dari Iran ini, kita waktu itu memang fokusnya cuma mau buktikan apakah ada transmisi atau enggak. It will be better if we include the more holistic ya, from culture, from ini. I know Mbak Ina ini strongnya tentang kualitatif. Jadi dari etnografis, dari pendekatan cross-culture budaya juga sangat important. Kita waktu itu buru-buru pokoknya harus jadi karena ngejar tayang, karena memang timely banget waktu itu. Jadi banyak orang nanyain, ini gimana? Jadi kita pengen ini. Jadi fokusnya waktu itu adalah apakah terjadi atau enggak. Could be critical, systematic review, dari systematic review juga ada loh sebenarnya. Kayak scoping menjadi dari rapid ke rapid. Bisa jadi ini sebagai bahan, a baseline untuk melakukan systematic review yang pertama, kemudian ada orang lain lagi, mungkin teman-teman atau semuanya melakukan literature review, dan ini salah satu masuk literature systematic review, bagian yang mengasuhkan adalah tentang apakah budaya seperti kedekatan keluarga atau itu juga mempengaruhi itu. Tapi ya feeling saya sih artinya adalah itu kan termasuk milieu ya, lingkungan. Lingkungan juga sebenarnya berdampak di sini, beberapa tadi bilang, termasuk yang waktu diterimanya, ada yang tadinya misalnya negatif, tapi kalau diterimanya dia di situasi yang tidak memperhatikan protokol kesehatan, dia menjadi positif gitu loh. Yang itu bisa berdampak juga kepada si bayi yang baru dilahirkan. Gitu ya. Jadi kalau di antara keluarganya juga tidak mengindahkan protokol kesehatan, ada kemungkinan juga.
Hi guys, how you doing? I would like to know how is the coronavirus situation in your country? How are you dealing with the coronavirus?
Okay, are you?
Mungkin bisa langsung sekalian, Pak.
So, can you repeat again, Lopez?
Well, I was just saying, if you are able to tell me how's the situation, the coronavirus situation in your countries, and how are you dealing with that?
How are you deal with the patient? Oh, you're talking about Indonesian case one, yeah? Okay, so
yeah, I'm talking about Indonesian situation.
Okay, yeah. So, thank you, Sheila, or you, Abigail Lopez, or you are using Anna Abigail Lopez, yeah? Thanks for the question. So, if I have the case from Indonesia, I haven't got any specific study yet, but this is based on my previous experience, like with Ibu Ina from Litbangkes Ministry of Health, when we visit like Nusa Tenggara Timur, this remote island. So usually they use kind of like as the casual business. So having pregnant women to be accepted in the health usually is kind of like sharing with other things. It's not specifically, oh, this is taking care of the mother pregnant. But sometimes in the remote area, you may share with other patients. They may have asthma, they may have coughing, they may have from very mild until very severe like one. Okay, it could happen that's kind of like affect each other. But in the capital cities like Jakarta or other big cities, Bandung, Surabaya, and so on, there is more specific place that you pregnant women can go directly to special clinic or special hospital. So that's more kind of like the study that I have here. So it's kind of like more specialized. Nevertheless, if you have more kind of like people who has kind of like facility sharing with other people, the risk of get the first place coronavirus from others is much bigger than those in the kind of like in the specialized one. So I think in Indonesian case, it varies from one region to the other regions. So for capital cities or big cities, maybe less because they have more kind of like specialized. But then for other places where sharing about the facilities still big, then also the risk is become bigger. That's Lopez.
Baik, terima kasih banyak Pak Salut. Apakah sudah cukup Pak Lopez jawaban dari Pak Salut dan juga Bu Lina? Mohon maaf tadi terpotong. Apabila ada yang masih mau dielaborasi, nanti kita bisa diskusikan kembali. Selanjutnya saya ada Pak Nur Hadi barusan request untuk bisa bertanya. Dipersilahkan Pak untuk bertanya.
Halo, selamat siang Pak Salut.
Hey, Mas Nur.
Pertanyaan saya mengenai ini ya Pak Salut, apakah dari 9 studi itu ada kasus kematian baik bayi atau ibunya?
So far, thank goodness, no. Tidak ada.
Oke.
Okay. Iya, nggak ada ini yang dilaporkan meninggal ya. Kalau ada, kenapa kira-kira?
Karena kan risiko kematian kan cukup besar ya untuk mereka yang terkena COVID. Mm-hmm. Nah, saya tertarik juga apakah mereka yang hamil kemudian punya anak, apakah bayinya atau ibunya meninggal karena COVID. Nah, kalau nggak ada, mungkin pertanyaan yang kedua tadi Mbak Dinda nanya mengenai comorbidities. Apakah ada comorbidities lain? Misalnya ini tadi ditemukan tidak dalam bentuk sesak napas atau yang lain, cuma ada bentuk misalkan tidak bisa merasakan makanan atau tidak bisa mencium bau. Itu juga salah satu ciri dari penyakit COVID.
Oke, terima kasih pertanyaannya Mas Nur Hadi. Saya harus baca lagi list komorbiditasnya, karena memang beberapa disebutkan situ. Jadi kita bagi-bagi as a big authors, we sharing the roles, ya. Someone who's screening that one, and then someone treated this one. Okay. But if I can read again the paper who has comorbidities, they don't mention any specific comorbidities beside related with the respiratory system one, other than that one. Except they do have like a backache, and then they use kind of like a history of what they call it, the not having delivery, but premature delivery one. So that's kind of like also may have my impact to that one. So unfortunately, from the study that we had, we don't have that things. But again, as I said, I would like to recommend everyone who's interested in this study, we can make it a little bit bigger, including those with the comorbidities. Maybe the specific question, because our question is about whether there is a vertical or perinatal infection, rather than whether the comorbidities can like affect or not. I'm welcome to that question, and then to expand this study for the next one. Yeah. Mungkin begitu Mbak Dinda sementara.
Terima kasih.
Yeah. Juga Pak Nur, Bapak Ibu yang lain, apakah ada pertanyaan lagi yang diajukan dalam untuk bahasa Indonesia? Dipersilahkan. Saya tidak melihat ada yang raise in saat ini. Tapi mungkin apakah boleh diceritakan Pak Salut? Jadi dengan kondisi ibu hamil terberat, apakah kira-kira dari hasil systematic review Bapak gitu ya yang terlihat gitu Pak, kondisi parah yang seperti apa, terparah seperti apa, dengan COVID seperti apa, dan kemudian bagaimana impact-nya terhadap bayi yang dilahirkannya.
Okay. Case by case ya, ini kalau dilihat dari beberapa studinya, ciri-ciri umum yang seperti pada bayi Asia lainnya nampak juga, seperti kayak ada bercak-bercak kuning gitu ya, kayak apa yellow face, kemudian ininya. Nah, itu dia tadi yang premature in particular, dia itu kena COVID, tapi juga mungkin ada komplikasi lain sehingga membuat dia premature, bayinya lahir harus didahulukan dibanding waktunya. Nah, itu low birth weight pasti ada jadinya. Kemudian tapi bukan karena itu, kan karena premature ya, jadinya makanya low birth weight. Dan juga ada beberapa yang harus disinari karena yellow, kita bilangnya apa, jaundice ya, bilangnya agak kuning gitu kan. Nah, tapi kan itu juga terjadi pada yang tidak COVID juga gitu loh, ibu-ibu yang tidak COVID. Nah, dan terutama untuk Asian mothers ya, makanya masih trivial agak ininya, apakah karena itu apa enggak. Jadi yang kita sasar waktu itu apakah dengan memberikan breast milk setelah berapa hari juga ada kasusnya. Ternyata juga enggak gitu ya. Makanya konklusi yang banyaknya adalah bidang tidak ada evidence bahwa terjadi transmisi antara ibu yang COVID dan kepada anaknya. Mungkin harus dilebarin terhadap kasus di US, di Eropa, kayak di Italia dan Spanyol atau Jerman, kemudian juga di Asia. Itu bakal jadi lebih seru lagi gitu. Lihat hasilnya seperti apa ya. Kemungkinannya pasti akan terjadi variasi yang banyak. Tapi saya sangat highly recommend untuk study apa dengan systematic review atau scoping atau sebagainya, karena selama kita dalam situasi pandemik ini kan susah ya kalau mengadakan langsung. Jadi kita biasanya palingan review paling gampang kan. Kita punya Google, terus kita punya database-nya, sebagainya. Itu bisa dilakukan nggak cuma tentang COVID-19 ya. Misalnya, highly recommend untuk teman-teman yang sedang S2 atau S3. Kan biasa, kadang awal-awal proposal kan harus literature review. Nah, itu bisa dijadikan paper sendiri kalau misalnya literature review-nya sangat komprehensif, malah bisa jadi paper sendiri gitu ya. Karena kalau di Australia kan untuk S3 harus ada publication. Biasanya kita encourage kalau memang dia literature review-nya bagus, kita encourage berubah menjadi more sophisticated, jadi systematic review. Itu malah bisa jadi bonus dia sendiri menjadi satu paper sendiri yang kita encourage. Seperti sekarang, Tro dan saya lagi lihat tentang new capital cities. Pertanyaannya, bisa nggak new capital cities ini untuk systematic review? Saya cari-cari, agak sulit itu. Cari yang cuma ada Canberra, terus yang baru Malaysia, kemudian jadi cuma ada spesifik-spesifik. Recommended-nya dari teman bilangnya mendingan scoping aja karena nggak ada sangat ininya gitu loh, variasinya. Jadi itu mungkin yang nanti harus ditentukan kapan mau doing scoping, kapan mau mau rapid atau mau systematic review. Jadi bisa dipakai general atau bisa juga untuk specific question kalau teman-teman yang masih belajar atau junior-junior yang baru riset. Mungkin itu.
Tangan.
Ya, turun nanya.
Because I'm also a host, so I don't have that feature as well. So, Salut, my question is this. You guys set out the criteria, isn't it?
Yeah.
Of what you think you consider important and stuff. Isn't it actually a little bit of arguing after the fact that you actually simply want to see that this area is important, this area is important. What if actually there are some criteria that are not listed in your list?
Mm.
I mean, how do we avoid this thing? Because I did some quick calculation. You actually only use 0.6% of the literature that you found.
Yeah.
That's 0.6%, not 6%, 0.6%. Less than 1%. So, what do you think?
Thank you, Turo, for the question. When I come up with this idea and the student also I questioning her, I said, how that's possible from 1500 to become only 11. So we search kind of like justification from any publication in systematic review. So even some kind of like a big name using bigger post proportion in the first place, but end up having only like 8 or 7. I was really kind of relieved a bit. I know that, but that's why, I mean, like systematic review being named as systematic, it means you've been done some step by step what you did. As basically academically as well as scientifically, it can be accepted as long as you can justify why you come up with this number instead of big one in the first place. Yeah. So because you need to be able to say something. This is already kind of like very robust and rigorous selection is not just based on randomly that one. So that's why for the systematic review in the first place, you need to have specific question. So as long as that relevant with your question, yeah, like Ibu Ina from Litbangkes asking, why don't you look at the culture? Yeah, that's important, but that's not in my research question. Yeah. So that's why if I expand a little bit that, I may be able to kind of like include what she want to see from that one. See, the answer may be trivial, but that's my scientific answer at this moment.
No, the reason why I was asking that, it means that we do have to be careful about which one that we pick as our reference.
Yeah.
Not just whenever there's something related to COVID, we just enter and then we think that that's important.
No.
But could it be actually some papers or article are important to the issue but being left out simply because of your selection criteria?
Exactly. That's why, as I said, there are the methodological appraisal that you need to kind of like follow. So the one that we follow is from the NIH, National Institute of Health, about looking at for the case report and then case studies, what the criteria that you can include in terms of systematic review, if that one. If you look at that, the symbol I put as like smile or not smile. So smile, it means the answer is yes, yes to all this kind of like item. Then yes, I will include. So our criteria is about like 70% and above. If they answer yes to all the criteria, then we include. We didn't include those one because of when we put against those criteria, they didn't match. So I think you're right. So it's very kind of like need to be careful when you select that best, and also based on what criteria you use. Maybe when you use something else criteria, like the mixed method one, it could be different because they're only looking at specific item.
Thank you. I mean, this is a really interesting in terms of the content itself and also the method, because what we come up with content, often we forget that it depends on which method that we actually choose. Thank you, Salud.
Terima kasih juga Pak Salud untuk penjelasannya. Menurut saya ini sebuah refreshment pengetahuan juga bahwa metode systematic review bisa digunakan terutama di masa pandemi juga ya, untuk komplement di saat kita tidak memungkinkan untuk melakukan survei secara masif misalnya. Oke, Bapak Ibu, ada kemudian apakah ada lagi yang ingin bertanya? Menggunakan bahasa Indonesia tidak apa-apa. Bu Omas, mungkin saya melihat ada Bu Omas, ada Bu Lilis, ada Ibu Diana juga. Apabila ingin bertanya, kami persilahkan Bapak-Ibu sekalian semuanya. Sebagian besar peserta webinar kita hari ini datang dari Research Institute, ya. Kemudian juga ada government institution. Tapi mostly 86% sekitar 80% perempuan, Pak. 60% perempuan dan 40% laki-laki. Jadi isu maternal ini juga menarik mungkin untuk Bapak kalian untuk, dan juga dari
untuk untuk slide-nya saya sudah kasih ke Mbak Dinda ya.
Baik, Bapak Ibu, apabila tidak ada yang ingin tanya kembali, mungkin apakah kita sudahi Pak sesi ini? Dan Bapak-Ibu sekalian bisa mendownload, jadi webinar kali ini direkam dan download, ada di link yang nanti akan kami berikan. Kemudian juga materi ada di Dropbox yang juga bisa kami beritahukan. Jadi di bit.ly FKP, FKP-nya huruf kapital semua, karena ada FKP dengan huruf kecil juga, FKP 2020 yang berbeda, jadi pastikan menggunakan capital letters. Nanti akan kami berikan materi dan juga recording dari sesi webinar kali ini. Itu saja Bapak-Ibu sekalian, apabila tidak ada yang dipertanyakan, saya tutup mungkin dengan sedikit konklusi bahwa sejauh ini dari hasil systematic review yang dilakukan, belum bisa dipastikan ada vertical transmission mungkin Pak ya, karena masih perlu penelitian lebih lanjut apakah dihasilkan dari proses kehamilan itu sendiri atau proses di luar itu, artinya ketika kontrol ke vaskes gitu ya, kemudian tenaga kesehatan yang juga menangani, juga keluarga di rumah, serta personal hygiene dari ibu hamil itu sendiri sangat penting. Jadi sebagai peringatan juga bagi kita semua di era pandemi ini, untuk stay safe, kemudian tetap gunakan masker, jangan malas untuk cuci tangan, gitu ya, jaga personal hygiene kita semua, agar kita semua bisa memutus mata rantai penularan COVID bersama-sama. Mungkin itu saja, Bapak-Ibu sekalian, terima kasih banyak untuk partisipasinya di FKP kita kali ini. Sampai jumpa kembali di FKP Lembaga Demografi berikutnya, yakni di tanggal 11 Agustus, di jam 10 pagi juga. Terima kasih banyak, saya tutup. Selamat siang semuanya. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Saya kembalikan ke MC. Silakan.
Thank you, Dinda. So, thank you, Salut. That concludes our session today. As Dinda said, on the 11th of August, there will be another session. And Dr. Zainal Abidin Simanjuntak will present his paper on CSR between needs and requirement of the company. So please join us again, and then the other five will be coming. Thank you again. So see you in the next session. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you, everyone. I've muted everyone, so if you want to say thank you or give a clap to Pak Salut, silakan. Thank you for joining today, this morning.
Ini juga akan kepada Bapak Ibu. Dalam
terima kasih, Lid.
Dia. Sama-sama. Ya, sama-sama.
Thank you, Dinda. Yeah. Jadi, there are still a lot of people still. And some people just entered actually. Just trying to join.
Salah okay. Jam.
Tapi kan kita mungkin salah jam. Ini kan sekitar 1 jam ya. Tadi kan telat sekitar 8-9 menit. Jadi emang benar-benar 1 jam ini ya. Apa namanya durasinya.
Tadi Flora dengan Ari katanya mau tinker with the controls. So when people are around.
we will have a meeting because probably next time because we will be using the webinar Zoom, there will be that feature using Q&A session thing. So we will talk about. Okay, thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you. See you later.
This is a nice one. Yep. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Mas Gali.